Good evening, all of you. Though this presentation should have been there at the start of this refresher course, but somehow my slides were not very nice, as told by Dr. Sahu. So let us start off with the pre-anesthetic checkup once more. So we all understand what is the pre-anesthetic checkup, because the outcome of any perioperative situation that is based on whatever the information that anesthetists have beforehand. So the pre-anesthetic checkup is basically an assessment, a clinical assessment of a patient, where we gather certain information about the clinical condition of the patient at that particular point of time, which help us to decide about the perioperative management, the postoperative pain management, and if any sort of specific consultation, any specific investigation, any modification of the medicine is required. The perioperative care and pre-anesthetic checkup is a little bit different. The perioperative care means the overall care before, during, and after the surgery. But the pre-anesthetic checkup is a clinical assessment of a patient at a particular point of time before surgery. So, because as it has been shown in this Australian incident monitoring study, that around 11.6% of the pre-anesthetic checkup, that is inadequate and incorrect. And out of that 11.6%, 3.1% adverse incidents are seen. Among this 3.1%, more than half of them are preventable, and possibly more than 20% are possibly preventable. Only 5% incidences are there which are not possible to prevent even after a good pre-anesthetic checkup. So such a huge amount, huge accidents or incidents or bad adverse events happens just because of lack of proper pre-anesthetic checkup. So what is our goal of pre-anesthetic checkup? It is to create a rapport between the patient and their families, to allay the anxiety of patient as well as the patient's attendant. And it also helps to reduce the overall hospital stay, unanticipated ICU admissions, any morbidity, perioperative morbidity, undue cancellations of the cases at 11th hour, and also increase the overall quality of treatment during and after surgeries. So there is a two terminologies, the pre-anesthetic consultation and pre-anesthetic assessment. Basically, pre-anesthetic assessment is the integral part of the pre-anesthetic consultation. The overall pre-anesthetic consultation means the assessment of the patient and optimization of the patient if any morbidity is there, and overall plan of the anesthesia as well as perioperative pain management, discussion with the attendants and the guardians, and also in obtaining a proper informed consent regarding anesthesia and the risks. So for every assessment, clinical assessment, there should be a proper place. The pre-anesthetic room is the place where pre-anesthetic checkup is done, where the privacy for the examination, proper disinfectants should be there, and appropriate equipment required for the examination as well, assessment of the patient should be there. So this gives us a time for assessment, appropriate optimization for the surgery, anesthesia, and pain management, which is especially important for the patients with the comorbidity and the major surgeries specifically. So conditions where the pre-anesthetic checkups are not possible, that is emergency surgeries, the labor patient, and patient mostly when they are admitted in the ICU and we need an emergency exploration. So pre-anesthetic checkup is not possible in that case. That is sort of extreme emergencies. So for every management of the patient, there must be certain guidelines according to which we go ahead. So guidelines for the pre-anesthetic consultation is that, first of all, the introduction of the consultant to the patients. Introduce yourself appropriately to the patient that I am your anesthesiologist and I am going to take care of you throughout the before, throughout, during, and after surgery. And confirmation of the patient identity, what is the surgical as well as anesthesia plan is there, what is the site of procedure, and who is the procedure, means who is the surgeon over there. Appropriate medical history to be taken. All the medical records which are previous medical records which are available with the patient should be checked. Appropriate examination. Any medication which patient is already taking, or any medication which is required to optimize the clinical condition or morbidity of the patients. Review all the investigation, what has already been prescribed, or advise certain investigation. So for appropriate level of the care, there must be appropriate facilities for the treatment and monitoring of the patient, not before surgery, even after surgery also. Appropriate staffing must be there, appropriate equipments, and for particular information to the patient as well as guardian about the anesthesia, sedation, pain management, and potential complication and risk of the anesthesia, perioperative. So there should be an appropriate informed consent, and certain additional medication can be prescribed according to the morbidity of the patient as well as for the pre-anesthetic medication purpose. So when we go for the anesthesia or when we go for any procedure over the patient, we must always explain about the potential risk of that procedure. But the risk could not only is not only on the basis of anesthesia, but it is only based on surgery itself. So we divide the surgery into three grades. That is minor, intermediate, and major surgery. The minor surgery, which are basically the surgical procedure done over the skin and skin appendages. Intermediate surgery, just deeper to the skin, or like tonsillectomy, the varicose vein and inguinal hernia repair and so on. And the major surgery is done where any of the cavities are open, like thoracotomy, abdominal, and major vascular surgery, neurosurgery, head and neck, thyroidectomy, and so on. These are considered under major surgery. So the overall risk as well as morbidity of the patient, that is analyzed by on basis of the ASA physical status, that is American Society of Anesthesiology physical status. This ASA has been ASA-PS has been developed in 1941 by the Myers Squibb. But the disadvantage of this ASA-PS is that there is no consideration of the type of surgery and no consideration of any diagnostic studies. So there is another, again, classification has been stratified, that is Johns Hopkins risk classification system, but here only surgical risk had been considered. So right now we are practicing very commonly the ASA physical status classification. You all very well know the E stands for the emergency surgery and ASA class 6, which are a perfect donor. But when we talk about, when we assess, clinically assess, or we do the pre-anesthetic checkup, we not only take history and examination of the patient and any certain medication, but we also prescribe certain investigation. There is a lot of confusion what investigation to be prescribed. So this is a small chart which has been given here, where the investigation, the most common baseline investigation suggested to the patient on basis of type of grade of surgery as well as ASA status. So in case of minor surgery, in ASA 1 and ASA 2, most of the time there is no specific baseline investigations are required, except in ASA 3 and 4, where if there is any sign of acute kidney injury, you can go for the renal profile assessment. And for the ECG, the 12-lead ECG, there are certain protocols we'll discuss later where the ECG is required. But if you go for the intermediate grade of surgery, in ASA 1 and ASA 2, the full blood count and hemostasis are not routinely required, whereas in ASA 3 and ASA 4, if there is any comorbidity or any system involvement like the renal system or the cardiovascular system, we can go for, or any signs of infection or sepsis is found, we can go for the full blood count. For the hemostasis, basically coagulation profile, where the patient are already on the oral hypoglycemic, oral anticoagulants, and we need to modify the treatment or change the oral anticoagulants to parenteral drugs. In that case, we need to get the coagulation profile done. It depends on the patient to patient. So in ASA 3 and 4, for intermediate type of surgery, kidney function test definitely you should do, because the patient is already in ASA 3 and 4, and ECG according to the protocol we'll discuss. And the lung function test, when we found that any pulmonary function patient's pulmonary condition is not very good and we want to assess the pulmonary function by PFT, then first take an opinion with your senior anesthesiologist or a chest physician before going for the pulmonary function test. Similarly, for the major complex surgery, most of the investigations are required, except the coagulation test. Coagulation tests are only indicated where any coagulation derangements or any anticoagulants are being prescribed. So this is an exhaustive list. There are different investigations on basis of expected blood loss, the patient's age, and different medical conditions have been given. I'm just describing it in brief. Like here, it is given the expected blood loss for more than 500 ml, expected blood loss 50 to 500 ml, and less than 50 ml. So when the patient has an expected blood loss more than 500 ml, definitely we go for the hematocrit. And another baseline investigation is the type and screening and type and cross matching. But the chest X-ray is not done on basis of this expected blood loss. It is on basis of X-ray protocol. We'll discuss it. On basis of age, though we always prescribe the electrocardiogram on basis of age, usually in the patients more than 50 year of. Okay, so these are certain baseline investigation, different clinical conditions. As in case of age, because we prescribe ECG on basis of age, though ECG is advisable for when patient is above 65, But here it is standardized that above 50 year of age, every patient can undergo for ECG. Though with the ECG, there are very that affects your anesthesia plan, and it gives you any assessment of the post-operative morbidity in very less amount. Not a very significant advantage with the ECG with the every patient is found. So there is particular protocol for the ECG also. In the clinical condition like cardiovascular disease, hematocrit is a baseline investigation, the chemical basic, where six parameters are assessed, the sodium, potassium, chloride, bicarbonate, and renal profile and glucose. So similarly, there are certain baseline investigations which are being given in this chart. You can go through this chart and so let us see what are the protocol for the chest x-ray. The chest x-ray is not routinely indicated in any patient, any asymptomatic patient. It is only needed in those patients where any intervention is to be done in the thorax, lungs, or heart. There is definitely indicated. Any new onset of any cardiopulmonary symptom or recent exacerbation of any symptom. So what symptom could be there? There may be excessive cough, there may be chest pain, there may be orthopnea, paroxysmal nocturnal dyspnea, any ankle edema or decreased exercise tolerance. In that case, we should prescribe the chest x-ray, not routinely for every patient. Similarly, the protocols for the electrocardiogram, mostly the males and females above 50 year of age, you can standardize the prescription of electrocardiogram. But in the diabetic patients, if the ECG is available for within last 3 months and it is normal, then there is no need of an ECG. But if it is abnormal, then and it is within 1 month, then you can consider the same ECG. If it is beyond 1 month, then you need to repeat the ECG to see or compare from the previous ECG any newer changes. But if there is a non-diabetic patient, time span increase up to 6 months and 12 months. So, but there are certain special investigation. We have talked about the baseline investigation like hematocrit, renal profile, ECG, chest x-ray, coagulation profile, and so on. But there are certain special investigations like pregnancy test. It should be done in every childbearing female. There is sickle cell anemia, sickle cell traits, which should be done only if the family history is positive. Hemoglobin A1C is to be done only with the known diabetic patient and the patient who has uncontrolled sugar level, or the hemoglobin A1C is not done within previous 3 months. So hemoglobin A1C should always be taken as a fresh report. Routine urine test, it is not usually required as an investigation of choice for the anesthesia purpose because it doesn't affect the anesthesia. But only if there is any signs and symptoms of the urinary infection, then we can go for it. Otherwise, it doesn't affect much about the anesthesia plan. So fasting guidelines, yes, we always prescribe the fasting to the patient just before going for the surgery, and it is to prevent the regurgitation and aspiration. Fasting beyond 6 hours, it has no benefits. Rather, it has a deleterious metabolic effect and impact on the patient well-being. Even up to 1200 ml of carbohydrate drinks can be given to the patient just 2 hours before surgery. What are the clear liquids? The clear liquids which are transparent enough so that we can see through across the that liquid, like black coffee, clear tea, Pedialyte. But the cold drinks, the carbonated drinks are not considered in this list, because though carbonated drinks are clear liquid, but still they can cause the reflux. So universal formula of the all ages, like 2 hours, 4 hours, 6 hours, and 8 hours. 2 hours for the clear liquid, 4 hours for the breast milk and formula food, 6 hours for the semi-solid and solid food, and 8 hours for the fatty food. And if we go for the age specific, for the adult, 6 hours for solid food and clear liquid for 2 hours, whereas for the child above the 6 months, same solid breast milk or formula feed up to 6 hours and 2 hours for the clear food. But the children below 6 months, formula feed for 4 hours, breast milk for 3 hours, and clear liquid for 2 hours. That is clear cut guidance. So do a pre-anesthetic checkup, many of the patients may have certain comorbidity and they must be taking certain medications. So there should be any specific guidelines what medications we can take up to the day of surgery and what medication we need to stop. So all the cardiovascular medication should be continued except the diuretics, ACE inhibitors, angiotensin receptor blockers, and calcium channel blockers. These four category of cardiac drugs which should be stopped before surgery. All anti-reflux medication should be continued. All medication used for the seizure and Parkinson's should be taken as it is. All the psychiatric medicine should be continued, because if we stop it, there may be withdrawal symptoms. like benzodiazepine, so particular point should be kept in mind, like when the benzodiazepine are given, that may potentiate the effect of anesthetic agents. Antipsychotic, if you stop, because the decrease in the seizure threshold, there are chances of the throwing of seizures, there are chances of the neuroleptic malignant syndrome. Antidepressant may be continued if there is risk, there is a withdrawal symptoms. Similarly, all the bronchodilators, if the CPAP is applied before, specifically in the case of OSA patients, and corticosteroids or immunosuppressants, specifically corticosteroids, if more than 6 milligram per day for 6 months are given, then they should be continued as it is. Certain medication which should not be taken on the morning of the surgeries, that are diuretics, potassium supplements, vitamins, and all the oral hypoglycemic agents should be stopped, and the bolus insulin should be stopped. If bolus insulin is to be given because of too much fluctuating blood sugar, then that half of the routine dose should be given a night before or in the early morning, because patient is going to be neuroleptic. So the medication which has to be avoided in the perioperative period, the anticoagulant, oral anticoagulant should be avoided. The NSAIDs, the short-acting drug like diclofenac, ibuprofen, intermethacin, and ketoprofen should be stopped at least a day before surgery. The mid-acting agent like naproxen, Celecoxib should be stopped 3 days before surgery. And long-acting like meloxicam and piroxicam should be stopped 10 days before surgery. FOX2 inhibitors should be stopped at least 2 days prior to the surgery. So all the antiplatelet drug, there are certain protocol which may be discussed in coming lectures, where the protocols regarding the antiplatelet drugs and the anticoagulants must be discussed. So all the herbal medicine like ginkgo biloba, ginseng, garlic, ginger, green tea, vitamin E, though we are not in practice of using all these herbal medicine, but whatever the herbal medicines are being prescribed or given to the patient, they should be stopped very well, because many of these drugs, they may affect the may interact with the benzodiazepine and opioids and lidocaine, calcium channel blockers like St. John's wort. They should be stopped 5 days before. The valerian officinalis, which is used for the insomnia, and abrupt stop may cause benzodiazepine-like withdrawal, so it should be gradually tapered. The psychotropic drug, antidepressants are the most commonly used drug, and these are the selective serotonin reuptake inhibitor that may have very high, if they are stopped, then there are very high chances of mortality in hospital, and they may also lead for the readmissions to the hospital. So tricyclic antidepressant, because they reduces the presynaptic uptake of norepinephrine and serotonin, and also block post-synaptic cholinergic, histaminergic, and alpha-1 adrenergic receptors. So there are very high chances of hypertensive crisis if the sympathomimetic drugs are used along with this drug because of the synergistic action. And if they are suddenly stopped, then they may precipitate cardiac arrhythmia, the cholinergic symptoms, the movement disorder, and may relapse of depression, which is 5 times more potent than situation before starting those drugs. So SSRIs, they may lead to serotonin syndrome, where the hyperthermia, hypertension, neuromotor disorder with cognitive behavioral disorders can be precipitated. And this serotonin syndrome is specifically precipitated when they are when the tricyclic antidepressant myo-inhibitors phentasocine, pethidine, dextromethorphan, and dextramethorphan are given to those patients which are already on SSRI. So it should be kept in this should be kept in mind. They also inhibit the liver enzymes, so overall metabolism of all the inducing agents, specifically thiopentone, is reduced, and they cause increase in the potency of these drugs. So myo-inhibitors that inhibit the breakdown of serotonin, dopamine, and norepinephrine, so the blood pressure may increase along with sympathomimetic drugs. So abrupt withdrawal that may lead to suicidal tendency, depression, and paranoid delusions.
Along with this part, because of the synergistic action. And if you are suddenly stopped, then it will be spirit, cardiac arrhythmia, the cholinergic symptoms, the movement disorders, and may relapse of depression, which is 5 times more.
Chala, isi se chal raha hai na. Tum apne mein karo ya to tum apne phone se chalao isi se.
Hello. Is it?
SSRIs.
There are certain drugs for the post-operative nausea and vomiting, like corticosteroid, butyrophenones, antihistamines, that should be continued. So let us go further with the pre-anesthetic, another component of the pre-anesthetic evaluation, that is the examination part. In this examination part, we go with the vital signs of the patient, the height and weight, airway assessment, the neck assessment, heart, cardiovascular system assessment, pulmonary system, and the abdomen and nervous system. So let us go first with the airway system, because airway is the most important system, because all the anesthetists deals with the airway, and anytime there may be crisis, so airway should be assessed very well beforehand. So with the airway assessment, all the previous history and any previous anesthesia mishap or any difficulty during intubation or airway management should be asked with the patient. Any gastroesophageal reflex, any signs of or symptoms of obstructive sleep apnea, about the body mass index, the mouth opening and inside the gap, the modified malimpathy score, teeth examination, cervical movement, and so on.